up?
My name is Rachel, and this is Ethan. We are on Team 8371, the Awesome Nerds. Today we are going to talk to you about limit switches. We are going to go through what a limit switch is, why you would want to use a limit switch, how to wire a limit switch, and how to program a limit switch. Let's jump in! A limit switch is a switch that you use when your mechanical parts reach a certain point and you want it to stop. Essentially, a limit switch is used when you don't want your mechanical parts to go too far, past their limit, and break.
This is a diagram of a limit switch shown as a system of tracks. This is track 1, track 2, and track 3. In its normal state, track 1 goes directly to track 2. Then when you press the limit switch, track 1 goes to track 3.
To continue with limit switches, it is good to know why you might want to use a limit switch. First of all, limit switches allow for great control of movement. A precision limit switch can be used as a touch sensor. Precision limit switches provide accurate repeatability of electrical and mechanical operating characteristics. And any limit switch counts towards the controller board. There are many styles of limit switches for different applications. For example, the precision limit switch has many different styles, all under the name precision limit switch.
This is our team's hardware board, which we use to test the hardware functionalities and code before we implement them onto our robot. Over here, we have our limit switch. Before we get into how to wire a limit switch, let's familiarize ourselves with Ohm's Law. Ohm's Law shows the relationship between current, voltage, and resistance. In formulaic terms, it's written as R equals V over I, but we're using the equation in the terms I equals V over R. Using this equation, we can logically assume that if the resistance is zero, then the current it's drawing is infinite, and it's burning up the electronics. It's really important to follow Ohm's Law, because if you don't, then you can face serious damage to your components, ranging from a melted LED to a broken robotics core. Another important piece of info to know when wiring a limit switch is the very tiny letters written on the limit switch itself. As Ethan had said before, the NC is activated when it's open and the NO is activated when it's closed. Now that you know what the prongs mean, let's get into the actual wiring. So the Rev Robotics Hub has a resistor on it already, but we want to be safe. Or we want you guys to be safe and add a pull-up resistor, which connects the power port to one of the prongs. When wiring this together, you can put one switch in each port, or you can use logic to put multiple switches in one port. But that's a video for another time. Now it's time to test our awesome code.
To start, let's push that initialize button. Here you can see that our code is fully initialized. We don't have to worry about any other telemetry statements this far in the program. In the limit switch's normal state, isPressed was false. But then we pressed the limit switch and isPressed became true. So now we know that our code works.
Yay! Yeah. Now Ethan's gonna run through the code with you guys.
A great way to tackle the vast world of code is to divide the code into chunks. As you can see, I focused into our first piece. This focused piece contains our import statements. This allows us to refer to classes and other packages. Public class NerdLimit is the way to go next. This is where we will set up our NerdLimit class. So you got your dig in and your telemetry and hardware map, and we're going to use all those terms later on in the code. The next part of the code is actually seen by the user. The person using the code will see the telemetry in these chunks. Once the program has set up the hardware map, the telemetry, and the dig-in, it'll tell the user, hey, this part is initialized. For our next step, we're going to have to switch over to another class. We call it NerdHardwareBot. All the chunks from NerdHardwareBot are shown here. These chunks initialize the code our limit class will need. Our next chunk of code occurs once you hit start on your app. Now the user will see a message which says isPressed. The value after the telemetry statement is not a telemetry statement, so if you click on that, you can see that that leads us right into our next chunk. The last chunk is Boolean, so a true or false statement. It checks if the limit switch is pressed. If the limit switch is pressed, it'll return with a value of true. If the limit switch is not pressed, it'll return with a value of false. So that's it. That's the code.
That's all for this video. Thanks for watching and tune in next time for some more FTC knowledge. Be sure to hit that subscribe button and stay awesome, nerds!
You're still here? It's over. Go home. Go.